All right, we have discussed some very important cardiac definitions. Now let's get into heart failure. Unlike other cardiovascular diseases, heart failure is increasing in incidence and prevalence. This is due to improved survival after cardiac events and the growing aging population. In 2020, about 6.2 million people in the United States had heart failure. The American Heart Association estimates that we will have over 8 million cases by 2030. Heart failure is primarily a disease of older adults. Approximately 10 in every 1,000 persons over the age of 65 have heart failure. Pre-COVID, this was the most common reason for hospitalization in those ages 65 and older. The incidence of heart failure is similar in men and women. As I have said twice already, heart failure is a complex disorder. We can think about heart failure as the pump is failing. Our heart cannot pump effectively anymore. Because the heart pumps out oxygenated blood and nutrients to all of our tissues, heart failure starves the tissues of the oxygen and nutrients they need to survive. This causes cell damage, cell death, and leads to organ dysfunction and then failure. Although we teach body systems as their own topics, they are all interconnected. If one system fails, like the heart, it affects everything else. We used to always call heart failure congestive heart failure, but we've learned that not all heart failure will cause congestion in the body and lungs. So now we use the term heart failure and use congestive heart failure for patients with diagnosed congestion. The location of the congestion depends on the type of heart failure the patient has. Our heart is divided into quadrants. At the top, we have our right and left atrium, and on the bottom, we have our right and left ventricle. Our right side of our heart consists of our right atrium and ventricle. They work together to pump deoxygenated blood from our periphery to our lungs. The left side of our heart consists of our left atrium and ventricle, and they work together to pump oxygenated blood out of our lungs and into our periphery. Because our heart works side by side, we can have right-sided heart failure or left-sided heart failure, and eventually both. Typically, one side fails first, and the other side fails a short time later. Both sides have different signs and symptoms, so it's important for us to know which side is affected by our patients. And sometimes we can tell just by looking at our patients. Most patients typically start with left-sided heart failure. The left side becomes too weak to pump the blood out of the lungs and into circulation, causing the right side to become overwhelmed with all the extra blood, and then it starts to fail. We call heart failure that affects both sides biventricular heart failure, and it's associated with the worst outcomes. In addition, we can classify heart failure into systolic or diastolic heart failure. Is it a squeeze problem or a filling problem? And we can classify heart failure as chronic or acute. Block 1, we discuss chronic heart failure, and in block 4, you'll discuss acute heart failure, as these patients are typically critically ill. Heart failure is not a disease alone, like pneumonia or diabetes. Instead, it's a disorder that is associated with numerous cardiovascular diseases. Most commonly, long-standing systemic hypertension will cause heart failure. Other causes include coronary artery disease, which causes blockages in the coronary arteries and can lead to myocardial infarction, or MI. One-third of patients who had an MI develop heart failure. Patients who had rheumatic fever as a child can develop a condition called rheumatic heart disease, which can cause heart failure. Thankfully, the incidence of rheumatic fever has decreased significantly and is not as common. Patients with congenital heart defects are at risk for heart failure because the structure of their heart is abnormal and may not function properly. Patients with pulmonary hypertension have abnormally elevated blood pressures inside of their pulmonary blood vessels, making it harder for the right side to pump blood into the lungs. Cardiomyopathy is a disease of the heart muscle itself. The heart muscle is no longer strong enough to pump effectively, and it's usually caused by a virus, pregnancy, or drug abuse. It is not heart failure, but the disease causes the heart failure. Patients who have hyperthyroidism can develop heart failure due to thyroid hormones causing the heart to be stressed by working harder and faster until the muscle starts to fail. Patients with valvular disorders have structural abnormalities for several reasons that do not allow the heart to eject blood appropriately. Myocarditis is an inflammation of the heart muscle, typically caused by a virus or drugs. The muscle becomes inflamed and cannot squeeze effectively. Drug abuse can cause heart failure by damaging the heart muscle in myocarditis and cardiomyopathy. There are a lot of other conditions that can make heart failure worse or exacerbate heart failure. This slide isn't for you to memorize, but for you to understand how much disorders of the body can affect other body systems. Right-sided heart failure is when the right atrium and ventricle are too weak to pump blood from the periphery to the lungs. Right-sided heart failure can be caused by left-sided heart failure. The left side is too weak to pump the blood out of the lungs and into the periphery, so it backs up into the right ventricle, causing it to fail. Right-sided heart failure can also be caused by an MI in the right ventricle. The MI causes ventricular muscle damage, leading to weakness. Right-sided heart failure can also be caused by pulmonary hypertension. The blood pressure in the blood vessels is so high in the lungs that the right ventricle cannot push blood into them. This causes a condition called cor pulmonale and leads to right-sided heart failure. When the right side fails, the right ventricle is too weak to pump blood from the periphery, so it starts to back up. The veins in the periphery start to become overloaded with fluid. The pressure inside the veins starts to increase, and when the pressure gets too high, the fluid has nowhere to go but out, and it goes into the tissues, causing edema. That edema can be anywhere from the toes all the way up to the liver, including organs, if it's not treated. Left-sided heart failure is caused by a weak left ventricle that cannot pump blood out of the lungs and into the periphery. This is usually caused by hypertension, coronary artery disease, and mitral and aortic valvular disorders. When the left side cannot pump effectively, oxygenated blood cannot leave the lungs, so the lungs get congested with fluid and the patient has a hard time breathing. This also decreases the amount of oxygenated blood that gets to our tissues and organs, so we start having tissue and organ damage. Left-sided heart failure can be divided into two more categories, systemic and diastolic. In systemic heart failure, the left ventricle is just too weak to pump blood effectively. The muscle is not strong enough. In diastolic heart failure, the left ventricle is too stiff to relax fully and fill with blood. It could be too stiff because it's inflamed from myocarditis or way too big like cardiomyopathy. We discussed ejection fraction earlier, and now I'm going to relate it back to the heart failure and why it's important we know our patient's ejection fraction. Systolic heart failure is the most common type of heart failure. That weak ventricle can't squeeze hard enough to get the blood out of it and into the periphery. The left ventricle muscle wall becomes thin and dilates out like an old, wrinkly, used balloon. The EF of these patients is less than 40%. That means they cannot get enough oxygen to the cells, and it means too much blood is left over in the ventricle after each contraction. In diastolic heart failure, the ventricle doesn't relax and fill completely, therefore it doesn't have a lot of blood to pump out. These patients typically have a normal ejection fraction, but if we looked at their stroke volume, it would be lower because the ventricle can't hold a lot of blood. This short 8-minute video from the Khan Academy does a great job reviewing the pathophysiology of heart failure, and I highly suggest reviewing it. Remember how I said right-sided heart failure cannot get the blood from the periphery and into the lungs? Well, most of the signs and symptoms we will see are related to excess peripheral blood or edema. We can see JVD from the extra blood trying to get into the heart. We can see enlarged livers and spleens from the excess fluid seeping into the organs. The patients can have anorexia, the I can't eat type of anorexia, nausea and abdominal pain from the excess fluid building up around their abdominal organs and in the abdominal cavity. This also causes abdominal distension, and these patients can look 18 months pregnant. We will definitely see dependent edema from the toes all the way up to the sacrum, scrotum, up the abdomen, and even in the fingers and hands. These patients may complain of polyuria at night, which is going to decrease their quality and quantity of their sleep. These patients also become weak from carrying around all this extra fluid weight and from the lack of oxygen to their tissues. These patients will gain weight very quickly, multiple pounds of fluid weight overnight. You and I drink a liter of water a day and then we pee it out. Heart failure patients may only pee out 50% of the water they drink. That extra water stays in their body and seeps into their tissues. Heart failure patients can have increases or decreases in their blood pressure. It will increase because of the extra fluid in the vascular space, and they can also have low blood pressure because the heart is too weak to pump at a decent pressure, or they can become intravascularly dry, so their veins and vessels are dry, because all of the fluid has seeped into their tissues. Left-sided heart failure cannot pump the blood out of the lungs effectively, so the symptoms we see in left-sided heart failure are typically pulmonary in nature. We can see dyspnea and tachypnea as the patient is trying to breathe with extra fluid in their lungs. These patients can start having a dry, non-productive cough, but as the pulmonary congestion worsens, the cough becomes moist and productive. If the congestion gets really bad, the productive cough produces a pink, frothy appearing sputum. That pink is blood. Pink, frothy sputum is bad. It's a sign that the lungs have so much fluid in them that they can no longer exchange oxygen and CO2. This is an acute or block 4 issue. These patients will develop orthopnea, which is difficulty breathing while laying down. You'll often see these patients sitting like a tripod, hunched over a table or a desk trying to breathe. They have fatigue and weakness from working so hard to breathe and the lack of oxygen to the tissues. These patients can also become anxious from feeling like they can't breathe, and they may become depressed because they cannot function as well as they used to. These patients can also have nocturia, but be oliguric during the day. These patients can develop angina, which is chest pain, palpitations of the heart, so they start feeling some funky heartbeats, and be tachycardic from the heart struggling to increase the heart rate to increase their cardiac output. If the heart failure gets bad enough to lose oxygen to the brain, these patients may become confused, restless, and agitated. They may become dizzy and pale and may even develop weak pedal pulses because the heart can't contract strong enough to get the blood flow to the feet. If the heart is over full, some patients may develop a third heart sound called S3. They get a lub-dub-dub instead of a lub-dub. The human body is very smart. It can sense that things are not working as well as they should, and it takes steps to fix the problem. We call this compensation or compensatory mechanisms. The body will stimulate the sympathetic nervous system to increase heart rate and blood pressure to increase the cardiac output. This works for a while, but it will start causing increased afterload, making the heart work harder to get the blood out, therefore lowering cardiac output again. The brain will sense low cardiac output and signal the release of antidiuretic hormone, or ADH, which is our anti-pee hormone. This causes vasoconstriction and holding on to fluid in an attempt to increase our cardiac output. Our renin-angiotensin system will hold on to fluid to increase the blood volume in an attempt to increase stroke volume, therefore increasing cardiac output. The walls of the ventricles will start to remodel, getting bigger and stronger. However, the ventricles getting bigger starts to have a negative effect and leads to contractility dysfunction, weaker contractions of the heart. This causes the heart muscle to get less oxygen, work harder, and get weaker. Our beta-type natriuretic peptide is a hormone released by the ventricles of the heart when they sense fluid overload. BNP promotes vasodilation and diuresis. Then the body senses the loss of fluid and activates all of the above systems again. All of our compensatory mechanisms start to play against each other. Some systems cause the body to hold fluid, some cause the body to excrete the excess fluid, and then these measures start to spiral out of control. They can't stop working against each other. I call this the downward spiral to hell of heart failure. Once this spiral starts, healthcare providers work very hard to stop it. There are many complications of heart failure. These are just some of them. The lungs can get overfilled with fluid, causing pleural effusions and pulmonary edema. The heart muscle can lack so much oxygen that the conduction system starts going haywire and we get dysrhythmias. The stroke volume decreases, leaving extra blood to pool in the ventricles, which then leads to clots and forms ventricular thrombi or blood clots. The liver will enlarge, causing hepatomegaly, which affects coagulation factors and bleeding times, and decreases the liver's ability to filter out waste products. The kidneys become overloaded with fluid and hormones, telling them to hold the fluid and release the fluid, so they start to fail. These complications start to spiral out of control and eventually will cause death. Yet another reason why I call heart failure the downward spiral to hell. All right, we're going to take a break now.